I'm Forbes Lipschitz, and it is my pleasure to introduce Susannah Drake tonight. She is the founding principal of DLANDstudio Architecture and Landscape Architecture, a firm that I had the pleasure of working in for 2 years, based in Brooklyn, New York. Susannah is a registered architect and landscape architect, and also has her work featured in the permanent collection at the Museum of Modern Art, so quite an accomplishment. Since founding the firm in 2005, Susannah has been a powerful advocate and voice for green infrastructure. She has the unique ability to identify and ferret out unseen opportunities for ecology in the city. And I think it's not an exaggeration to say that she's a change maker. She doesn't wait around for projects to come through the office. She identifies opportunities that need to happen, and she finds ways, finds partners, agencies, and funding to get it done. I think a testament to her relentlessness in this pursuit is the Gowanus Canal Sponge Park. And through a very unique model, she raised the funding from the New York State Council on the Arts, the United States Congress, the New York City Council, the New England Water Pollution Control Commission, the State Department of Environmental Conservation, and the New York State Environmental Facilities Corporation. The project has received awards from the National AIA and ASLA, and was finally the pilot project was opened this year. And I'm sure we will hear about that and much more. So please join me in welcoming Susannah Drake.
But as Forbes suggested, we kind of have a new paradigm for practice. I would bike around the city, or I'd see things that were just not working, and they seemed so stupid. And I thought, you know, we've got to make change happen. But as a small business, and particularly a small WBE, DBE, it was hard to actually get the jobs. So I thought, well, okay, how am I going to develop my vision if I'm not getting the jobs to make the change happen? And so I started to apply for grants to look into doing research that could then be applied. And you're going to see a lot of examples of that today. But in kind of placing the work in context, some of the things that we did early on, we developed a methodology of just kind of implementing something. And this was a pop-up park that we did at Brooklyn Bridge Park. Now, this is not Michael Van Valkenburg's Brooklyn Bridge Park. This was done with his blessing, I just have to say, or at least his acceptance. It was done for a summer before the park opened, so they were set to break ground the following year, but Olafur Eliasson's waterfalls were going to be up, and so they wanted to make it accessible. And so we put up this park for, you know, like $3 a foot, and created this really lively open space that attracted 300,000 visitors over a very short period of time, over about 10 weeks. We also have done a lot of pilot projects where we're testing an idea or a piece of potential infrastructure. This is the American Pavilion for the Milan Expo. This is the hold system, which is a system for managing stormwater coming off of raised highways, and then the Sponge Park, which I'm going to talk about a bit later. I'm going to talk about all of these later. And then more permanent solutions where we're creating very sort of refined details and more enduring landscapes that can be really making change within an urban context that was formerly somewhat blighted. That one's in St. Louis. So a lot of the work that I do relates to political geography and the sort of shape of the way the American landscape has evolved. And some of that relates to, say, the Land Ordinance Survey and thinking about the relationship between resources and economic development. And this little image over on the bottom left is kind of important because that's actually a different view than the gridding of the country, because that one is actually Powell's map of the watersheds of the West. So there are two different ways of thinking about landscape, right? And there are lots of different ways that you can think about landscape and that you can communicate information about the landscapes upon which you're working or which you're working with. So looking back to Thomas Jefferson and the sale of land, of creating the land ordinance grid, they needed money to make the country run. So they created this grid to figure out a way to actually, you know, parcel out that landscape. And so they created these territories, townships, and sections, parceling off of the landscape, that really didn't relate to the geographic conditions. It was really just a very geometric kind of distribution. It also was different than Lincoln's Homestead Act, because Lincoln's Homestead Act created systems for sale of smaller parcels of land, and he actually opened up the sale of land to African Americans, people of color in general, and women. So that was important, happening 100 years later. But one of the things I want to call out in this image is that you have these geographic systems that are running through this landscape that really are running counter to it. And I find that that tension between the structure and the ecological system is actually really quite fascinating and fruitful. If we look at the New Deal of FDR, $20 billion was invested into our national infrastructure and public buildings in 1934. That created the Works Progress Administration, creating new parks, and also creating these incredible civic buildings across the country. So there was a national investment in important civic projects. It also created the Tennessee Valley Authority with power, jobs, and flood control coming to rural communities. And thinking about these ideas of massive ecological change is something I've been considering for a long time. This is a painting or an inkwash drawing I did back when we drew in grad school, looking at the differences in how a landscape is formed based on these massive, or reacts to these massive ecological, or these massive infrastructure projects. But the term infrastructure as a term only developed in the World War II era in reference to military logistical operations. And General Eisenhower invested $25 billion in the creation of our federal highway system. He called it the Federal Highway Defense System. And that was really important because you had a country that was coming back from war and, you know, was thinking about security. And that was a way to get the political backing around a project to create what actually ultimately became a sort of giant economic development engine for the United States with the creation of the suburb with all the post-war development. Unfortunately, there are still representatives who consider creation of highways as essential to economic development, but happily that view is becoming more nuanced and we're getting sort of wiser people in government sometimes. So.
The problem is, though, when our infrastructure is not being destroyed by robots and or saved by Bruce Willis, we tend to find it a bit boring.
As you know, infrastructure is not a sexy or glamorous topic.
As much as I like to think otherwise, infrastructure is not sexy.
Infrastructure is not very sexy.
Yes, infrastructure, like those men we just heard from, is important but not sexy.
Well, I know it's a gimmick using John Oliver, but at least I got you all laughing. But it's important because, you know, we look at those projects and you look at that infrastructure and it's very gray and it's very hard and it's very utilitarian. And in my view, we can start to transform infrastructure and create something much more beautiful and much more productive. So what's going on here? Oh, there we go. So, but this isn't necessarily a new idea. There we go, that's the right people. Because in 1965, I'll actually say it, the year I was born, the Highway Beautification Act was signed by LBJ, and there was an incredible uproar about that because there was a feeling that it was too much control, because what they wanted to do was actually create a much more beautiful landscape along the sides of the highways and control all of the billboards and the sort of ugliness that was happening, and instead replace it with something much more verdant and beautiful. So, but a lot of the work that I do actually relates to thinking about these roads and these watersheds and their relationships. And I come from Vermont, and you can see how, you know, on some levels it's really convenient to build your road next to your river because it's a clearer landscape. It tends to be sort of an easier place to get through you're going through the mountains. You might be clearing trees, but you're not necessarily clearing through rock. But unfortunately, you have these issues when weather starts to become more extreme. So I see that the potential for creating opportunities between some of these infrastructure systems and the greening of the city. And we've been doing a lot of work in New York City with the Department of Environmental Protection on the new green infrastructure standards, creating new bioswales. A lot of that work is actually coming out of the work of another president, Richard Nixon, who signed the Clean Water Act and the Clean Air Act acts in the early 70s. And what has happened is because of that national legislation, which grew out of the environmental movement of the 60s, there's been a lot of pressure from the federal government to have mayors actually act to make change happen. Now, Bloomberg was a very enlightened mayor and helped to push forward Plan YC for a greater, greener New York, but he was also incentivized by a $6 billion consent decree from the federal government to create a new green infrastructure system. So it's quite good that Nixon signed that legislation because it means that the mayors actually have to act, and it's becoming a priority. So, oops, we gotta go back. So in thinking about infrastructure, this is a competition that actually Forbes led in my office. And it was for thinking about the relationship between infrastructure and urban design and how we might be able to make change in Montreal, but how Montreal acts as a kind of microcosm for the entire country, or in all of North America. And I know some of you have already seen this, but I want you to recognize that a tremendous amount of information and work went into the creation of this video, which presents a really completely new vision for how to transform Montreal. So you can communicate a lot in a very short amount of time if you're very careful about how you edit it and put it all together. So that's an important kind of lesson to take away. Hard transitions with my videos, sorry. So going back to water, there are 772 U.S. cities that have combined sewer systems in the U.S. And I don't know if you're familiar with the concept of a combined sewer overflow. I assume the landscape architects are. But if you're not, it's basically where if you have a lot of storm drainage and that gets connected to the sanitary sewers, so that if you have too much water entering the system, the water will overflow into the surrounding water bodies instead of making the sewage treatment plant not work. So it's intended as a sort of safety measure, but unfortunately it means that a lot of effluent ends up in our waterways. And we have Thomas Crapper, in part to blame for the invention of the combined sewer, not because he invented the flush toilet, but because he popularized it, and it became so popular that they needed a very quick fix in order to manage both sanitary sewage and the storm sewage. But unfortunately, this is the result. We have all of this this really dirty, toxic water going into our waterways. And I think, you know, now there's much more of a new awareness of urban hydrology, but these yellow dots are showing the places where you have tier one, tier two, and tier three sewage treatment outlets. So you have these sort of effluent hot spots. And one of the hot spots that I've been working on for the last 10 years is the Gowanus Canal area, which is right there. And that's where we invented, and I use that term very intentionally, we invented something called the sponge park. So we're not putting sponges in the ground. What we're doing is trying to create a message, you know, it's almost like a PR message saying wetlands act like sponges and can absorb surface water runoff. But I wasn't going to go into a community and say, I'm going to put a bunch of wetlands in your backyard, because that just wouldn't fly. So we said, we're going to design a sponge park. And this sponge park is going to absorb all your surface water runoff and make the Gowanus cleaner. So we explained how we were going to take the water from the storm drains and divert it and use it in these landscapes that would be publicly accessible new spaces. It was a very unique process, as Forbes suggested. We got a lot of funding from different not-for-profit and public agencies, but kind of through this slightly convoluted process of applying for grants. Some of the grants were small, for say $10,000 or $20,000 or $30,000, and some of them were much larger, for up to $500,000. But we put it all together and managed to convince the public agencies that it was a good idea. And that happened in part because we were working in the Bloomberg administration, which was quite enlightened. So we got the Department of Environmental Protection, Department of Transportation, and the Department of Parks to all work together, even though they hated each other, and to sign this memorandum of understanding to work together and get behind this project, in part because we had so much public support for the sponge park. Everybody in the community wanted the sponge park. But we still had to fight really quite tenaciously for years. This is the edge of the Gowanus Canal. It's quite degraded. This is actually this shipping container was a boathouse for a canoe club. So people would actually go out on the canal, even though all the surface water runoff was flowing into it. And this is actually raw sewage sitting on the top of the canal. So you have all this, you know, the sort of normal surface water detritus plus raw sewage, and it's not exactly a nice boating environment. But so our idea was to try to restore some of the former hydrology that existed in this area that was originally a swamp. So we wanted to make the landscape more spongy. We wanted to make it able to absorb surface water runoff, and also try to create landscapes that people could occupy over the sort of hydrologically productive zones. So we worked a lot in section. And that was important because, you know, you can be so reductive in section, right? You can make a lot of decisions very quickly and start to think about the relationships of things without having to figure everything out. And again, that's the comment for student process, right? Because it really works and it's helpful in your design process. But here you can see how that might play out with, you know, the water would actually go underneath this pathway and you could have plantings on either side. As we were designing a pathway around a 1.8 mile long canal, what we recognized was that it was an industrial site, and what the black is showing is places where the buildings that existed in the area actually abutted the canal. City planning had a notion for creating a continuous esplanade around the waterfront. And we thought, well, gosh, that seems kind of short-sighted because it's an industrial site. And by making an esplanade, you're basically erasing its history. And there was a lot of community pressure to maintain at least the idea of this industrial neighborhood, that it would still be a place where people were making things, light industry at least, but still making it cleaner. And so we thought, well, why don't we propose a different kind of system, a walkway that could exist along the waterfront in some places, but then might sort of wrap back into the community, and think about that as this linkage, which would make this whole area a new green district. So we created this different kind of urban promenade that would help to make the whole area greener and cleaner, rather than just privileging the water's edge, which had been done in so many places around the city, and it made those waterfronts fairly generic, actually. So just to give you an idea, this is a pretty important diagram, because this is why it took me 8 years to plan and get the approvals for a really small pilot project for this sponge park. But the sediment underneath the canal is controlled by the US Army Corps of Engineers, as is the waterway, because it's a navigable waterway. The first 5 feet of soil in the upland area is controlled by the Department of Environmental Conservation, which is a state agency. The water that flows over the ground is controlled by the Department of Environmental Protection, which is a city agency. The green is controlled by the Parks Department because it's planted. It's a road, so it's technically owned by the Department of Transportation. But then even like the shade over the water is controlled by the Department of Environmental Conservation. So we had all of these regulators who were making decisions, including, you know, the fire department and the sanitation department, which you'd expect. But then we were doing all this work to get the 200 approvals that you need for any waterfront project in New York City. And then the whole area was designated an EPA Superfund. So then there was a whole process that was involved in getting approval from the EPA Superfund people as well. So it just has made it take a little bit longer. But as Forbes suggested, I'm tenacious and will not give up. But we proposed this overall idea of cultural redevelopment as well as the greening. And happily, a lot of projects are actually happening. So we proposed this as a new arts building, and a philanthropist bought it and is developing it as an arts building. And we were working on that for a little while. And then we have also been working on this pilot project to do a street end. And what we recognized quite early on was that, you know, this is a massive project to create this whole green district, and that it was going to need to happen incrementally. So we're proposing the idea of a continuous hydrology, but we're not going to have a continuous hydrology, at least initially. So how do we create methods for creating systems that can be implemented over time that might actually become something that is a city standard? So this is what we got the funding for to do this initial pilot. We calculated the amount of flow going into the canal from the streets, and we actually chose the one that we thought was the least contaminated, and it also had the greatest amount of water flow in it. And created this first pilot. And just to give you an idea of how it will work, here's another animation. This one won't blast your ears out. This one's silent. So this is the existing condition. So there were these green streets that they called them. They were Parks Department kind of you know, planters, but they didn't allow water to infiltrate into them other than what fell on them. And then we put in some upland street swales, and then we created the sponge park out of bioretention cells. We had these concrete cells. So we wanted to create in a modular way so that it could be constructed very quickly and easily. There's an integrated sidewalk sedimentation basin, and then there's a sand filter. The sedimentation basin is actually really, really important in green infrastructure elements because the silt can clog these systems really easily. So when it rains, some of the water is trapped by the upland bioswales, and then some of it comes down and goes into this sedimentation basin. We have gabions in the sedimentation basin to kind of help trap the sediment. And then the water will flow into the different cells of the bioswale or of the sponge park. And if it rains a lot, more than the 1.2-inch storm, which is what we designed for, which is the 90% storm, then the water will go into this sand filter. And then that will then overflow into the canal. So, and then, you know, over time, the plants will grow, get all happy. Hopefully, although I have a story about that, and people will come and use it. And people are already using it a lot more than they did in the past. It's when I first went down there, I thought it was a really scary place to go. Now it seems much, much safer. It's just much more populated. So this is it on October 21st of last year, where we were putting in the cells. We ended up in construction, or in the whole design development process, deciding to take out the walls in between them, but we still used precast concrete so that it could be put in place really quickly, which turned out to be a really good idea because this is an area that's influenced by tides. So we had to, you know, put it in at low tide and, you know, sort of shore it up It was a challenge, or it wasn't a challenge because of the way we had designed it, actually. So here it is with the soil coming in. And then this was it in May 2016. And you can see it looks really awful. So what happened was, and I'll tell you, this is kind of funny. So with all of our projects, with all these bio infiltration projects, we're actually doing monitoring. We're trying to monitor the water going in and the water going out. And we're testing the amount of water, and we're also testing the toxicity of that water, right? Because the thing is supposed to work to clean this water and to hold it. So we test the soil, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's just so salty. What happened? And the contractor said, oh yeah, the salt water's coming in every time there's a full moon. And we thought, well, that doesn't make sense. You know, we've designed it so that the water won't ever overtop unless there's like some huge storm like Sandy, right? Some big hurricane. And the plants were chosen so they could handle periodic inundation from salt, but not once a month, right? And that was the implication here, that this was getting flooded all the time. So we thought, all right, we have to get to the bottom of this. So this is May. And what we found was that we had the housing for the monitoring equipment. So, you know, we have all these gauges and things that are in this PVC pipe and has a lid on it. And what was happening is it was going underwater and it wasn't sealed well enough. So the water wasn't actually going over the top. We had designed everything exactly right in terms of the elevation of the walls that surrounded the sponge park. But we hadn't accounted for the seal on the monitoring equipment. And so all this salt water was like bubbling up from below. So that was kind of a nightmare, but at least we found the answer. So, but this is July. So, and we've planted. And we have all this soil that we spent years designing and getting in the ground, and it's all salty, and I don't know, what are we gonna do? So we ended up washing out the soil and putting in some additives and then replanting in July in New York City, which is really stupid. But, I mean, it is. It's like, it's foolhardy to do it. But we decided that we would do it and we would water basically twice a week. So we did that, and this is what it looks like now. So I'm happy, like everything is just, is really doing so well, and it's growing in, and it just, it's turning into the landscape that I envisioned, and it's really exciting. And by the way, this is actually the new sort of ramp for the Gowanus dredgers, because they are still foolhardy enough to boat along the Gowanus Canal. So there are 7,200 miles of bridges and elevated highways that run through U.S. cities, and 666 miles of elevated structures are in New York. And I was the urban design fellow for the Design Trust for Public Space, and we were tasked, or we had the mission of trying to figure out what to do with those spaces. We developed seven different typologies, or looked at seven different typologies, and looked at sort of a geographic distribution of where we wanted to operate and do something with those different types. We looked at the clover, which is sort of the ubiquitous clover leaf that's everywhere in the country, the landing where a bridge touches down, a train trestle where you might have major acoustic issues, larger elevated highway structures where you have a very broad canopy, areas within parks where you have a bridge structure touching down, and then span where you might have an event that or a program that could happen on either side of a bridge. And then cluster was one where we had a lot of different forms of infrastructure coming together. One of the powerful things that we've mapped to try to get things done is the aging of infrastructure, looking at how that might help to prioritize where these projects would happen. So we started to look at that across the city and help to find our sites. This is one example in the Gowanus Expressway where we had a very broad highway deck with a lot of space underneath that was currently just used for parking. So we thought, well, why don't we actually repurpose that space? This area is fairly close to the Gowanus Canal, and it's an area that is being sort of pushed by the city to become a new artist district. And we thought, well, maybe some of the sculptors and the artists who are getting pushed out of Gowanus could come into this area and have temporary studios or places where you could do welding or do sculpting or have places where you can make a mess and you can make noise underneath the highway. And then we thought, well, maybe there's also a way that we could do some temporary pop-up bioswales, maybe above ground. And then ultimately, repurposing this area with more permanent studios, making spaces, or basically making that space more useful. So that was one thought for the use of this under the elevated space. And then there was another area, Broadway Junction, where when you get off the subway, it's just incredibly sort of discombobulated. It's really confusing, and it's hard to know where to go. So we thought we could create a new public space that had that used art and green infrastructure elements to help with wayfinding and placemaking within this under the elevated space, which is actually incredibly beautiful. The quality of light under these train trestles is amazing, but it's just a really kind of scary landscape at the moment. We also looked at opportunities for managing the stormwater, and this was something I did before working with the Design Trust, but this is a huge problem where there's no outlet for this water. This has all come off of the raised highway, and there's nowhere for it to go, and it's a public health problem. And so we developed this thing we call the Holds Scupper to manage that water. We came up with a couple of different prototypes. This is another project that was funded through a grant from the Department of Environmental Protection. We had these modular bioswales that we ended up building out in Flushing Meadows Park. These are concrete. It has a sedimentation basin and then a planted zone in each type. So this is an example of one of those bioswales. Helena, I do get to call you out. So this is Helena when it was going, it was being installed, making sure the plants are all in the right place. You can see that this is the downspout before it's actually been retrofit, We had to get approval from the State Department of Transportation to retrofit that pipe. And part of the reason that had never been done before is that the DOT just never really cared very much about it. But they have some really smart landscape architects who now work there, and they thought, wow, that's actually a really good idea. Let's try it. And because it was something that could be reversed, they thought it's worth the chance of doing it as a pilot. Now, this is the other one that we made out of gabions with the thought that it could enable infiltration into the surrounding soil. But one of the issues that we had when we designed this was that we created, again, in the monitoring equipment housing, the perfect habitat for a muskrat. And he moved in, and apparently the angle of the bottom of the vault that the monitoring equipment sat in was like the exact angle of a muskrat lair. Like, who knew, right? you just don't think about these things when you're designing. But so we have not introduced bobcats into Flushing Meadows Park yet, but that's just sort of there for scale. But we did have to redesign to keep the muskrat from destroying our monitoring equipment. You design for nature and you get nature. There are 35 million U.S. residents who live within 100 meters of a four-lane highway. Again, with a grant from the New York State Council on the Arts, I developed this vision for capping the BQE, the Brooklyn Queens Expressway, in Cobble Hill and Carroll Gardens. And I developed a whole series of drawings. And this was in part because when I started my firm, you know, I had some residential work, and I had a little bit of city work as a subconsultant, but I wanted to be able to figure out like what I wanted to do. And so I applied for these grants to develop my own body of work so I could work through a lot of the ideas that I had. So it was really important to be able to sort of develop that independent of an actual real paying project, but it was quite useful. Because we did this research that ended up being applied to a real project. And part of what we looked at with this was the economics of planting or of creating this new landscape. That if we planted 350 trees, we would generate $250,000 of oxygen production, almost $500,000 of pollution control, $300,000 of water recycling, and contribute almost $4 million in shade value for a 10-year gain of $50 million. Now, this was, you're probably wondering, where did all these statistics come from? There was this U.S. Forest Service book that was really kind of long and complicated, and we took that and turned it into a one-page diagram. So that's some of the power that we have as designers, is that we can communicate information. Really, you know, information is actually quite complex. Simply, and make it into something that's quite powerful. So, and speaking of power, the landscape on which I'm working was designed by Robert Moses. And, you know, he did create a lot of playgrounds and parkways and parks around the city and added housing to New York, but also created places like the Cross Bronx Expressway and the Brooklyn Queens Expressway that were really, you know, pretty hard on the communities. So I just want to read this. And he, Robert Moses, spent a lot of time looking down at it, watching the cranes and derricks and earth-moving machines that looked like toys far below him, moving about in the giant trench being cut through mile after mile of densely packed houses, a big black figure against the sunset in the late afternoon, like a giant gazing down at the giant road he was molding. Now, he had this hotel room in the Bossert Hotel, which actually looked down on this. So his view is this image. So he could actually see this whole road being constructed and cutting through the what they call the donut of the brownstone Brooklyn developments. You know, they call it the donut because there's a hole in the surrounding. So that was the in a way, kind of the bait and switch. He promised the verdant parkway and gave people the six-lane highway. And that highway creates physical boundaries. And it also has had some major kind of demographic issues. When I was working in Cobble Hill and Carroll Gardens, that area had already been gentrified a lot. But on the water side of the trench, the property values were much, much, much lower than on the upland side. So this demographic or these numbers are a little bit skewed because they are an average. But up in Southside Williamsburg, both sides were really impacted in a very tough way. And after doing that initial vision work, my firm was actually commissioned to do a real project looking at Southside Williamsburg, where the median household income is $40,000 a year instead of $80,000, and the population is much greater, about 160,000 people, mostly Latino. So it's an area that is kind of plagued by gang violence, and it's also an area that has major public health issues. So there are high asthma rates, there's low physical activity, and there's relative poverty in relation to the rest of New York. It is an active recreation desert. It takes a long time to get to ball fields. And so through a series of public meetings, this is Diana Reyna, who is our client, she was a city council person, we asked the community what they wanted. So, you know, I took that initial vision that was done with the New York State Council on the Arts grant and went to the community and said, what do you want? And what they came back with was they really wanted a place for active recreation, but they also wanted to be able to have some more passive landscapes as well. So we developed a section that had both. So we have these spaces that are fairly flexible fields, but then also these tree-lined edges. And part of that was because we had to be very strategic about how we were going to construct this. We're going over a state highway, and when you have a state highway, it tends to be federally funded, and when you make any changes to a state highway that's federally funded, you have to meet federal highway standards. So what that meant was that we needed to have 16 feet of clearance underneath the roadways. So we looked at the feasibility of where this could happen, and we found that there were three blocks where it was actually possible because we could get an intermediate support. But in one of the blocks, it really wasn't possible because we would have had to have a structure that was too thick, and we wouldn't have been able to get the clearance. So we were very strategic. And if you think back to that drawing, you'd notice that we had all the trees over on the sides. That was also in part because of the weight, because the center area, we knew that the Parks Department would require us to use field turf or artificial turf, but that actually worked out really well because it meant that it was a lighter topping on this structure. So, you know, it all kind of came together. So the BQE was constructed in phases, and this may seem like I'm going out of order, but this is important in relation to the relative obsolescence of the structure. So this section of the BQE was built in 1950, and the bridges that go over the highway have about a 50-year lifespan. So they need to be replaced. So we thought, well, okay, each one of those bridges costs about $10 million to replace. And that's an expenditure that the city has to make, even though it's a state highway. It's all very confusing in terms of who owns what where, which is why a lot of stuff doesn't happen in New York City. But we figured, okay, the bridges are at the end of their lifespan, so let's create an enabled economy. And let's use that $30 million city investment to get, say, a $70 million federal match to create this new park for the community, to turn this passive landscape into a more active component of the neighborhood. So there are 20,000 miles of rail trails in the United States. And this will be interesting to the people who are doing the bike trail this semester. And the Queensway is adding another 3.5 miles. The Queensway was a former rail line that runs from Flushing Meadows, from Forest Hills down to Ozone Park. It has 47 acres of land, 40 of which is DCAS property, which is sort of this holding organization, city agency, and then 7 of it is Parks Department land. We want to create a 21st century park for Queens, and we're working with the Trust for Public Land on the project. This is the existing condition, but this is also the existing condition. So parts of it are incredibly beautiful and verdant, and we want to be able to open this up so that the general public can use it. We divided the space into sections. This wasn't necessarily a phasing plan, but it had to do with the character of the places. We have the clearing, the North Passage Metropolitan Hub, Forest Park Grove, South Passage, and a section called the Elevated, which is very much like the High Line. CB9 and CB10 are really the most diverse in the city, which is kind of incredible. I think this is probably one of the most diverse places in the world. When you think about it, because we have people from just all over the place. And there are 322,000 people that live within a 20-minute walk of the Queensway. We developed different programs that could happen in the different places. And part of that was related to the physical conditions, the existing conditions. Like in the clearing, we were thinking about stormwater management and how the area is in a kind of bowl. And so that might be able to trap more of the water. There were existing ball fields. We wanted to capitalize on the programs that existed already and strengthen them by connecting them. And then also add some new programs. So this is the existing condition. You can see part of it is on kind of a hill. Part of it seems like it's in a valley, and part of it is on a structure. And that's because basically the topography is changing, but the train line has to stay flat, you know, because it's a train. And trains don't go up and down hills, no matter what Bjarke Ingels says. but this was a pretty interesting condition when we discovered it and we drew it, because what we realized was that this existed because of this ravine was actually not a natural condition. It was, they had to excavate all that ground to cut through the terminal moraine of the Wisconsin Glacier. And then they placed that, we assume they did a cut and fill, and they moved that, a lot of that ground up to the northern part. And that glacial landscape is kind of important because it came out in the in a lot of the details. Again, we have Ms. Steiner featured prominently. This is the existing condition. This tractor is actually still there. We took this quite a few years ago. It just sits there, and I don't really know why it's there, but it was sort of abandoned. It's not actually doing any work. But this is our proposal for the northern part of the Queensway. We drew upon the inspiration of the glacial landscape in making both a geologic reference and a cultural reference in creating these stone walls. So using that moraine material, the rocks that were left behind by the receding glacier, that was used, you know, hundreds of years ago by the early Dutch settlers in starting to demarcate their farms. We also created this landscape that was a productive landscape to manage the surface water runoff of the area, and then tried to add new programs. We installed very sort of carefully and surgically new seeding in the canopy that has grown up over the last 60 years. You know, when you're designing landscapes, you're usually given a kind of blank, well, you're often given a kind of blank slate, and you're planting these little trees, and you're gonna have to wait and hope and that they're taken care of and that they will grow to become these kind of incredible landscapes. But here, this landscape was left alone, was abandoned for 60 years. So we have these big, huge trees, and so we wanna keep them, but try to insert this seating so that we have an area where you can actually sit and watch your kids play ball without getting poison ivy or sunburn. One of the big challenges of the project was getting the community on board. You'd think that the community would be really excited about having a new park in their backyard, but a lot of people who lived in the houses that were right next to the Queensway were really worried about it. They were worried about privacy, and they were worried about people coming into their homes or peeping into their windows. So we created these diagrams that showed that that the paths would be a little bit further away from some of the houses that were perpendicular to the park, and then the houses that were parallel, it would be a little bit closer. We also developed some screening and buffering so that people would maintain their privacy, and we suggested putting up fences. We will have to do a lot of regrading in order to make this all work and to develop the two pathways through the site. But we're going to try to make it as limited as possible so that we can keep the big trees. We want to really create year-round use of Forest Park, which is a really beautiful Olmstead-ian park in the center of the site, and really try to activate that, create more access points from that upland area down into the Queensway Trail, and also create new educational opportunities. The first phase of the project that we're actually building now, or we're actually designing with the intention of building, is next to the Metropolitan Expeditionary Learning Academy. Yes, there is such a place. And it's right next to the park, and so we're going to create access up to new outdoor classrooms so the kids can learn about the flora and fauna of the area. And then on the southern part, we're creating this new kind of elevated landscape with a sort of a relatively passive program, but there are some places where we may be able to add some more active programming for night viewing of movies and things like that. So this is really, you know, it's the structure that's most like the High Line, but we imagine it as kind of an urban greenway for real New Yorkers because it's in Queens. So 40% of the world's population lives within 100 kilometers of the coast. And in 2010, well, quite a while ago, we were invited to participate in an exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art. And it was actually the first time that MoMA had ever commissioned designers to create work for the design department. And we collaborated with, or partnered with, Architecture Research Office to develop a way of rethinking the infrastructure of Lower Manhattan to protect it from a big storm. So if you look at the transformation of Manhattan over time, it's undergone a series of pretty remarkable transformations from 1650 with an edge that was quite hard or quite angled, not really conducive to having the boats pull up to its edge. So these slips were created in order to facilitate exchange. And then by 1960, we had all of these finger piers, which were put in place to facilitate even larger boats. But then containerized shipping was invented. And so there was no longer a need for this kind of landscape. And so by 2010, what happened is that industrial landscape was replaced by recreation and residential space as the highest and best use of this waterfront. So, you know, it may be easy for us to say, oh, how could we have turned our back on the waterfront for so long? But we didn't. It was the economic engine of the city. And then the economy changed. And so now there's a different economic engine, and it happens to be recreation and residential space. So now we've turned our back, or now we're like facing the waterfront again. So, but really important to the work that we were doing is looking at the subgrade hydrology, and this is important in all of our work, and thinking about the swamps and streams and sort of wetland edges that existed back in, say, 1845 when Egbert Vile drew this map, because a lot of those conditions want to come back. You know, you can only hold hydrologic systems back for so long before they want to reemerge again. They create pressure. So we looked at the value at risk, and I want you to just take a look at this line and then look at this line. You know, when you look at these, they're pretty similar. That 1865 waterline and the area where we could expect an 18-foot Category 2 storm surge to go are quite similar. So we mapped the existing seawall in 2010 and sea level rise by 2100, looked at the Category 2 storm inundation pattern, and then also brought in the combined sewer overflow issues, because Manhattan is just like Gowanus. We have the same combined sewer overflow issues. And then thought about how we would create a system where we could have water coming in and water going out to create this new urban ground. So we created level one streets for absorption. And what those were was I took all the infrastructure out of the street bed and put it into waterproof vaults underneath the sidewalk. The thought was that those vaults could have access points so that if the infrastructure became obsolete, like if you needed a new fiber optic cable or something like that, you could just open up the vault and snake it in. So it was a way of trying to make a landscape that was more interchangeable. But then the key was that the streets would then become permeable, because 28% of New York City is paved with roads. So we thought, there's an opportunity there. We could increase the permeability of the city and really reduce the combined sewer overflow problem. So there'd be level two streets for distribution and collection. Now this would be for if you had a bigger storm, but probably an upland storm, so freshwater storm. And there'd be conduits for getting the water out and sort of broader landscapes for absorbing water. And then level three streets for protection. This would be almost like a moat. This would be a large holding container so that if you had an overflow of an outbound barrier, that it would take the water, hold it, and then release it when the tide went out. And this created a whole porous green street system. We have a new 6-foot hardened edge. So I think this was something people weren't really paying attention to, because we had a lot of green fuzzy stuff along the edges in our renderings. But we were actually proposing to raise the level of the seawall by 6 feet to create this new sort of higher edge condition. But then we also, one thing that was important was that we kind of carved out Battery Park City to create new landscapes, these new waterfront parks, but also these new development zones, so that we're creating a new economic engine, but one that is responsive to sea level rise and climate change. And then we have these new freshwater wetlands to manage the surface water runoff, and then new salt marsh areas to help buffer the impact of storm surge to create a whole resilient system. So this is a view at over by Battery Park City, the Hudson River estuary. We've made it so that the small boat craft could come in to the area with these new development zones. And then down along the edge of Lower Manhattan, we had the Battery Breakwater. So this we imagined as a really fun place to go canoe, but it's also this protective landscape. And then along the east side, we had what we called the East River Esker and Breakwater. So it's basically like a larger mound and a new development zone all along the East River that had a landscape that would grow in strength over time, as well as these sponge slips. So in the place of the former economic exchange, we'd now have ecological exchange. And these areas would be places that could be inundated with salt water occasionally, but would be public parks. To create a new resilient city. Now, we recognize that climate change is a global problem and thought, well, let's develop some work. Again, this is Forbes' work, Forbes' drawings originally. But we looked at global landscapes and how we could create different kinds of protective ecologies, from the reef ecologies to mangrove ecologies, maritime forest ecologies. And what we wanted to do was look at how those related to different economies, from industrial to finance, tourism to informal settlements, and think about how we might be able to transform these landscapes. This is Miami Beach, and thinking about a sort of new prototypical section that might include constructed breakwaters and a kind of bermed beach, maybe reintroducing the mangrove ecologies, and then even having some kind of a wall, like a floodgate, and stilted buildings. So really thinking about a long-term transformation of the edge and the upland urbanity. Oops, sorry. I'm going the wrong way. But then we also thought about how we might have major impacts on other kinds of landscapes like agricultural landscapes. This is the Nile River Delta. And I think I'm actually going to have my students at Harvard this semester further investigate the potential for how this might develop. We tried to consider new forms of agriculture and how that we might get into a more export economy, or think about how we could create biofuel or some kind of sort of shift in the current agricultural system, which is all localized, but think about how it might become more international or national. So we did all of that work, and then we had this big storm called Sandy, and everywhere we predicted the water would go, it went, and all the lights went out, because they weren't in the waterproof, or the utilities weren't in the waterproof vaults. And it created, I don't know, something like $50 billion worth of economic losses for the city. And you know, in the aftermath of Sandy, there were proposals about putting in sort of giant floodgates, and they look like this, and, you know, this hard infrastructure. But the problem with these traditional methods is that they work for a while until they don't. You know, they only work up to a certain level, and that's based on what you can afford to create. And so it's a bit problematic. And so we thought, well, why not combine the natural and the constructed and think about how you could create a landscape that is both gray and green engineered to protect the edges of cities. And we did that for one of the state programs that followed Sandy for New York Rising, in reshaping the shorelines and thinking about these new protective landscapes. But we also worked on the project called Marshes, which created a new wetland mitigation banking system. So we had a degraded site, and we transformed this degraded wetland into a new healthy landscape. And the reason that's important is that the performance of this landscape is measured and it's valued, and it becomes a banking instrument. And that means that people can actually buy shares in this landscape. They can pay to make this landscape happen and pay to maintain this landscape. And their payment then goes to offset something they're doing somewhere else. So anything that's done in another part of the city to, say, protect it, like if you're putting in a new seawall that is 6 feet tall along the waterfront, and you're building that outbound of the existing seawall, that has an environmental impact that has to be offset somehow. So you could offset that by buying shares in this kind of a landscape. And this is the first wetland mitigation bank to go in New York State. So this was an important change post-Sandy. But ultimately, you know, my attitude is that the property values in New York are such that maybe we should think about moving away from some of these more vulnerable sites. Maybe we should create something that I call zone air, where we actually create a zoning bonus for some of the more valuable upland sites and transfer the zoning away from these vulnerable areas. So we create a process for relocating people away from these danger zones, and also for maintaining these new kind of hybrid gray-green landscapes that'll protect the rest of the city. So it's not always a very popular position, but I think it's important to consider. So I should segue into our Hawaii project now, but I'm actually segueing to St. Louis, our public media commons project, because it exists in a former parking lot. And I only have a couple more projects, so I apologize, I'm going a little long because I've talked much more slowly than I usually do. But the public media commons is in the Grand Center. It's next to the public television and the public radio stations, and in this sort of emerging arts district. And it was a parking lot, and we turned it into a new public plaza for the community. And it has a sort of range of different plantings that surround it. It was all supposed to reflect an RGB kind of idea with the plantings, red, blue, green. And the the place has become this kind of engaging and exciting sort of urban open space for the community between the public art and areas and the public television and public radio stations. We worked with an architect, Ben Gilmartin, and also Andrew Colopy on the design. And the media is integrated into the walls. This was actually a fashion show that was happening along the side. and an event that was happening at night. So I'm gonna actually go quickly. After we did that project, we also were then asked to create this public, this art walk along, connecting over to the front of the Sheldon, which is an art museum. And we, again, got a big grant from the local stormwater agency to create a new high albedo and high surface water runoff catchment area for this parking lot. So we thought we'd make it into something sort of fun and arty. Ultimately, the engineers didn't really let us go way arty, but at least we got a little bit of variation in the color, which was fun. So will alternate forms of food production change our views of farming? In last year, we worked on the American Pavilion for the Milan Expo, and we designed this vertical farm, which is about the size of a football field. And we called it Food 2.0. We worked with various chefs and people from the James Beard Foundation. We consulted with a lot of food experts. But ultimately, what we were doing was trying to reflect ideas about both American agriculture and celebrate that, because it's the American Pavilion, so we can't be too critical of large-scale agriculture. But we also wanted to think about how ideas about microclimate and soil and heritage seeds and all of these sort of things that have been so important to our kind of idea of American agriculture could be reflected in this wall. We had these pivoting panels that used a technology that was developed out of the University of Wyoming by a guy named Nate Story from Bright Agrotech. And it's called a zip panel. And you can see, you know, it's really cool on the outside in terms of the sort of lush, verdant landscape. But it's also creates this really beautiful kind of light quality on the inside. We had, I think, something like 50 different kinds of crops. The strangest one was the kohlrabi, which would sort of stick out and seemed like it would sort of fall down. But we had to be careful. You know, there's no squash. There's no tomatoes. You know, we have a lot of kale and basil. We did have strawberries, but and it created, gosh, it was just thousands of pounds of food every week. But I do want to tell a little story about Nate, because he told me a very funny story about how one of his biggest clients is actually this guy in Miami who has these greenhouses where they're growing just a ton of mint to make mojitos. So he's really like following the market to wherever it will go. And this is what I usually end with, but I do want to show you one more project. And I know it's long, but I'll go through it quickly because it's exciting to me, and I think might be interesting to you. We're now working in Hawaii, so we go from one tropical place to another beautiful tropical place. Working on a project in Manoa for the University of Hawaii. Hawaii is really fascinating, or Honolulu is really fascinating, and on the island of Oahu, because there's a relationship between the watersheds and the political boundaries. And that goes back, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years to the original kingdoms. But it's quite rare in other parts of the country to have that kind of a political division actually overlapping so clearly and specifically with watershed boundaries. But the area that we're looking at was originally agricultural in the 1890s. And the current agriculture on the island has gone way down. There just isn't the same kind of market for it that there used to be. This is a former agricultural landscape in Honolulu. And this is the university up here. But it's an interesting place to work because there's so much, so many different microclimates on the island. This reflects the rainfall for Oahu. And if you look at this diagram, you can see there's a tremendous difference between the upland areas that get 120 inches, 120 to 160 inches of rain per year, to the coastal areas, which only get about 20 inches of rain. So there's an amazing diversity. It's really quite fascinating. But one of the problems is that 75% of the landscape, or sorry, 30% of the landscape that's urbanized is creating 70% of the runoff. And so what we're trying to do is actually introduce new urban design standards for Oahu through some first pilot projects up at the university. So we looked at the stream profile of one of the creeks and showed the places where it was actually overflowing. And then where we have, we're going to be creating these different prototypes, as I said. We're working mostly on the University of Hawaii Manoa campus, and our site, our initial site, is up on the northern part. They have this really incredible Kanawai cultural garden down on the southern part, so we took that as an inspiration for a new landscape in this new agricultural research facility that we're helping them design. So this is the proposed site plan, and they suggested that we put buildings here and here. But after we did the site analysis, we were looking at the soils, and we were looking at the floodplain, and we said, well, gosh, that doesn't really make sense. Maybe what we should be doing is using these kinds of landscapes that you have on the southern part of your campus as a protective landscape, and then change your site plan based on the floodplain to create something that will, you know, not get damaged over time. So we're actually making a pretty big change to this, the idea of how this thing is going to work, but it's based on having it become more climate resilient. And so what we want to do is actually sort of unpave paradise. So, and that is it. So thank you very much.